Hello there. My name is Mark, aka the Canardian Jedi, and this is episode 100.
What?
100 freaking what? Episodes of this show.
This
holy crap, Charlie.
Makes it the last of our regular programs to hit the triple digits.
Yeah.
We're at about 138 over on Code. You yeah. guys are in the 150s, I think, over on co-op
mode,
and
yeah.
then SFU famously is now over 500.
Just hit 500. Wow.
Weeks ago. Yeah, we are incredible. 10 years and 3 months into this grand exploration that is SFU. So couldn't do it without. So very, very excited. Good stuff. Yes.
Amazing. Amazing. This is great. And to help us celebrate episode 100, of course, Charlie, this is the first time you and I have been together for a little while.
It's been a while. We've done some different projects.
We had a couple of episodes that I recorded at different cons that have happened recently, Marmora and EK Johnson, which was an awesome, fantastic interview. If you haven't listened to that one, pause this episode, go back, listen to EK Johnson talk all about the books that she's written and geek out about Star Wars and find out, like, there's actual Star Wars fans writing the books. Who would have thunk it? But like,
it had to happen eventually.
One of the greatest Star Wars fans I've ever had the pleasure of talking to. And that's saying a lot because we've done 100 episodes with a bunch of different guests. One of those guests is joining us again today. Alex, aka Turbo Nerd, just had you on a couple of weeks ago, or a couple of months ago, I guess, at this point. But yeah. Super happy to have you back. Thanks for joining us.
Yeah, happy to be here.
Cool.
Excellent.
Great. Congrats on 100 episodes. That's crazy.
Thanks.
Thank you so much.
We just keep rolling along, you know, and we've worked with so many great people across the board. And it's been an adventure. When it started, it was just Todd and me, and Mark came to us probably about 5 years in, and we spiraled from this, and we spiraled into our Patreon. Oh my God, look at that segue that I pulled
good
off.
Segue. Good
Do you
segue.
Like that? You bet. No, we've been for about 2 years now producing a lot of great extra content over on our Secret Friends Unite Patreon at patreon.com/secretfriendsunite. Go to that site, sign up for a free 7-day trial, and then it's as little as $2 a month to stay on board with us. Just like all these great folks, what do you get for that? Bonus content, early content, ad-free content. Content. Just a lot of fun.
Discord benefits.
Yes, exactly. So just a lot of fun stuff. Yeah, talking about geek stuff. These fine folks support us just like that. My buddy Derek, aka the Figure Dude. Francie, I'm going to add this, official hairstylist of SFU. Xbox Expansion Pass, Mr. Luke Lore, great guy. And my uncle Tim Horan. Love him. Friends with Benefits levels, John Sidorf, the awesome Phoenix Sisters Entertainment, Kelly and Crayley. Brendan Myers, Corey and HD, aka the CEO of the Boss Rush podcast, Matthew Keel. And we have a new guy, kind of my partner in crime on the media relations journalism side, Kurt Krug. And Mark, I don't know if you did this. Did we assign him his special Star Wars benefit? I'm trying to remember what we do. We give him a race or a special ability, something like that. And obviously it's very well thought out because we talked about it beforehand. And because Alex is our guest, he gets to play along too. So I'm trying to remember correctly. I'm going to say we name his Star Wars race because we also do that over on Code for Star Trek. So I'm going to say Kurt, he's very quiet. He's very thoughtful. He reminds me of Grand Admiral Thrawn. So he's a Chiss. Blue-skinned Chiss.
All right. See, I was thinking, you know, and that's a great answer. That you know, thinking of the Figure Dude, I was thinking of like a collector kind of thing. So I was
different fella. This is Kurt. He's my he's my journalist buddy. He's the guy that gets us all those beautiful
interviews. The connection. Right. Okay. Yes, we need someone with a lot of connections then. So Chiss, I think, could work. What race would have like the most kind of like the like a network?
Well, I'd hate to say the Hutts, because you know Kurt's in pretty good shape. I don't want to say he looks like a
right, yeah, I, and it can't devil. Be something insulting, yeah.
A Carillion smuggler, perhaps, like Lando. He was always connected.
Yeah. You know what? He could just have that kind of thing going on. You could do a Skakoan, you know, the tech. The tech race that always fiddling with the knobbies to kind of talk and stuff. Do that one. They seem like a race that would be, you know, pretty well connected doing the whole tech thing. Mm. Or we could just go someone with a really good built-in network, sometimes underground network. We could just assign them a Mandalorian.
Well, it seems like that would fit Alex's leitmotif without a doubt. What do you think about that, Alex?
Yeah, you know, always good to be a Mandalorian, you know.
Well, I mean, sometimes. Didn't work out so good for them at the tail end of season one of Mando. But often it's good, or when that big crocodile ate a bunch of them, you know. I mean, yeah. I guess sometimes maybe it's not great to be a Mandalorian, but sometimes it is.
Yeah. Any of those, I think really work.
Yeah.
So Charlie, final say. You know Kurt better than any of us. What's your final kind of verdict?
I think
what fits him the best.
Kurt, you know, he's very dignified. He's connected. He's Mandalorian. He follows all us journalists, because I walk that line as well. Follow a code of conduct. Kurt does that very beautifully. He's a Mandalorian.
All right.
There we
Congrats,
go.
Congrats, Kurt.
All right. Good deal. That's great. All right. So to wrap it up, again, please visit patreon.com/secretfriendsunite. You can get your own Star Wars race and your Star Trek race and a superpower that we talk about over on the SFU. We do that for all of our patrons who join up with us. Again, patreon.com/secretfriendsunite. 7 days for free. And as low as $2 a month for all those great perks.
We also have to mention our Secret Friend Super Squad that we almost got too distracted to mention. Sean Stella and Henry Nias.
Oh my gosh.
Too Nias family.
Sorry. Nias family.
Fantastic good folks. Family. Always the best. If there's Star Wars royalty is a race, that's what we're assigning them.
Right.
So thank you to that group. Thank you to everyone here.
Yes, yeah, absolutely. Gotcha. Well, cool.
Yeah, and we understand, like, if you can't or don't feel like throwing a couple of bucks our way, head over to YouTube or any one of our social channels, give us a like, give us a follow, and share a podcast with a friend. That helps us just as much as you know, throwing a couple of bucks our way. The more people listening, the more people watching YouTube, the better for us. Everything helps. So don't think in, you know, weird, rough economic times that, like, you have to throw a dollar our way. You don't. We appreciate it for sure. And we just gave a shout out to all those great people. But I get just as happy every time I see someone, like, share a show or, like, drop something in an Instagram story, like, hey, listen to this. Like, I get just as happy seeing that stuff as I do when I see someone new jump over on Patreon. So everything helps, everything counts. We appreciate you all.
Absolutely correct. Cool. Okay. Well, we're getting right into it. You know, Alex, like you said, has been with us before. We've gotten the ABCs of Alex. So we're going to get into, very briefly, talking about some incredible new content. But first, Mark, you found, and this was news to me, but you, I know you combed the internet for all these various sources to find stuff. There was a newer interview with Mastermind Dave Filoni. Talk about some of his projects. So what's going on?
That is correct. I'm just trying to find the YouTube channel. So this is from Extra TV over on YouTube. They just met Dave Filoni at a red carpet event for Skeleton Crew, the show we're going to be talking about in a second. But Filoni gave some great insight on a couple of projects that that we kind of, like, one that we really know about, and one that was kind of rumored and he just totally confirmed. So that's kind of nice. So let's start with the totally confirmed one. He just dropped that he is officially deep into writing Ahsoka season 2. That is his focus. That is his next big project. That's what he's jumping into. The interviewer if you go and watch that, and I'll try to remember to include a link to this in the show notes, but the interviewer mentions being a big fan of Rebels, and Dave kind of jumps in and says like, yeah, thank you. Me too. That's the next big thing I'm working on. And it's within this context of like Ahsoka season two that he's already been, he's already in the interview confirmed that he's writing, and then says like, that's the next big thing he's working on. So to me, it's a little vague of like, is he working on a different Rebels project, or is he just overall talking about like, because I mean, Ahsoka season one was basically Rebels season five. Correct. You know, like that was,
yeah.
Just toss a different name and kind of a different character's perspective on it.
Right,
like
right.
You're following that same storyline. You're following that same crew. So I'm assuming he was just talking about Ahsoka season two as a continuation of like the Rebels team. But like either way, there's either a Rebels project coming up or Ahsoka season two is just A, confirmed, B, confirmed to continue focusing on not only Ahsoka, but the entire Rebels crew.
Right.
Obviously she's trapped on a planet with Sabine, but like I'm guessing would also kind of maybe focus on some of the other crew, like Ezra, now that he's back in the main galaxy, like, is he going to turn around and try to find them again? Like, is there this big rescue? Like what's this going to be? So that's what I want to ask you guys is,
yeah,
what do you want from season two? Do you want it to be more focused on the planet that Ahsoka's on? Do you want this to be again, like Rebels season six? What's your desire for an Ahsoka season two? Alex, we'll start with you.
Yeah, I think kind of like you said, I think that it's sort of going to be like not just focusing on Ahsoka, but also the rest of the kind of ghost crew, you know, from the Rebels stories. And I think that's going to be great because I would love to see, you know, we didn't get to see Zeb back, but we've seen that he's going to be in the new Mando and Grogu movie.
Right, right. You know, yeah, because we saw him in Mando season three. Yeah, just I'll be briefly. Mm-hmm. And it was funny, they snuck that in there, speaking of Zeb, and I was like, is that Zeb? Because they said at the end of everything, he went off and he found his people, but then now he's back and he's with the New Republic. But why not both? You know? Yeah. You know what I would love to see if I might is kind of a Infinity War to Endgame 5-year gap. You know, so yeah, they, you know, much like with Ezra being gone for 9 or 10 years, which, you know, was not really, it was by design because again, you can't retroactively insert him into the original trilogy and he just pops out around the corner. Hey, how you doing? This doesn't make any sense. But you know, they finally make this breakthrough where they're able to rescue, Ahsoka, and Sabine, and Sabine's had 5 years to be trained and now she's street legal. She's ready to party. she knows how to more than just kind of swat with that lightsaber. She's in touch. It took her that much time to get in touch. And very weird to see how that plays out with Baylan. That could be a chance, unfortunately, for the character to go away, because that would be a natural way to address it that they do when an actor passes away. They you know, and then, but then for his ward, whose name is escaping me, the blonde woman, the one who looks like Billie Eilish.
Yeah, Shin Hati.
Yeah, there you go. For her to still be in the mix, and you know, for all you know, it told in flashback, maybe Ahsoka has brought her over to the side and maybe now they're all forced to be reckoned with. Who knows? But I would love that nice gap. It was funny, we were watching, because we're getting into Christmas movies and Christmas program, we're rewatching Hawkeye, the miniseries, and we're right at the episode where Yelena comes back and she's just splashing her face in the bathroom, and then she gets blipped, and then you see her come back by the room changing around her. So that 5 years gives so much, and I think about Endgame and what that long lead up was with, you know, Natasha's running things and Steve is running, you know, therapy groups in the city and stuff, and how people's lives can change, that we don't necessarily need to see every single solitary second of it. We can just advance the story by making this big jump. And then Thrawn has 5 years that he's doing whatever it is that he's doing kind of under the radar. And maybe he's finally gathered his power base that now we're ready for the final countdown, the big conflict. So I'm going to put my best money on a 5-year time jump. I think that'd be the best way to play it. Let some stuff happen behind the scenes so that we don't have to have endless flashbacks or waste a lot of time getting to the good stuff, you know, the nitty gritty. That's where I'm at.
I don't mind that for Ahsoka's story, but I think for Baylan's story, that would piss me off without some sort of supplemental, like Tales of cartoon or even a tie-in comic book, whatever. But like, he was clearly on the path to something, standing on those statues, pointing off in the distance. Like, he's on a mission for something, and a 5-year time gap just like glossing over, like, oh yeah, P.S. he found where the mother was buried, or like,
and then he unleashed and then he a demon. And broke his neck. Yeah.
Like, yeah. He just like, oh, sorry, he fell down the mountain. Like, no, I want like a recast to continue that character and what
that's fair. That's fair.
What he set up, because he did such a great job doing it, that I think just kind of like killing him off screen would be kind of a disservice to what we saw set up in that first season. So I'm like, I'm fine with everyone else. Like, do the first episode or two of Baylan's Skull, like what he went at, what he unleashed or tried to unleash, what happened, something. And then you can do like a gap of like, you know, he's meditating in a temple. He's doing this, like it's taking this long to center himself and do what he needs to do. Like, maybe that's where the gap goes, right? Like, everyone else is doing this, like Baylan like went into some sort of temple and like had to do some shit, and like that's where time to, and maybe it's not 5 years, but maybe it's like 3-4 you know, something like that, that or even two, like a 2-year gap would still, like, I think Thrawn's gonna be working pretty fast, so like even a little time jump of like there was some mystery there, I think could work. But I definitely don't want them to gloss over that. And he seemed so close at the end there, like standing literally on a statue pointing in the distance, but not like a 5-year distance, that I think there's some story there to tell, but everyone else, I'm like, yeah, whatever. fill in the gaps.
It's good. They'll find their way.
Baylan, we got to continue his story. I think, I think he's one of the best characters, like new characters from Star Wars in a long time.
Agreed.
So
agreed.
I would definitely love for them to continue his story.
Right. Yeah. So multifaceted, which you don't always get in science fiction, and particularly in pop, in what we might call pop science fiction or pop science fantasy, where something is, you know, maybe they don't necessarily deliver characters with a lot of dimension. Some Star Wars characters just aren't that way, but every once in a while villains. You get a good hit.
Especially villains, you know, a lot of time it's just, we're on the dark side. Why on the dark side? Because like for Darth Vader is one of the best villains ever, but like the first three movies it was like, hey, why are you on the dark side? I don't know, he was seduced by the dark side, don't worry about it. Like,
they gave me a cool helmet.
Prequels, you know, we got the prequels to explain that like years later, but like Darth Vader as a villain was just like designed as a villain. Every aspect of him was just fucking terrifying. He's so just, like,
his asthma plus his black outfit, but you know, red scary lightsaber. Yeah.
But now like, man, Star Wars have been cooking with the villains lately, between like Baylan Skull and like Stranger McSexy Pants from the Acolyte. Like, come on, you've got these multifaceted like dark side villains that are like, oh man, maybe these guys have a point. Maybe I can see the appeal of the dark side. Like, so I think, you know, no Acolyte happened. Like, Baylan Skull is the like hinge of this like multifaceted, interesting villain that I think, Alex, for sure, like, I agree that they need to continue that. You already mentioned we've got Zeb coming back in Mando and Grogu. You mentioned we saw him briefly, but like, he was also in the trailer with a little teaser for the Mandalorian Grogu movie. And that's the other thing that Dave talked about in this interview. Mando and Grogu has officially wrapped filming. Without getting too much into like what we've seen or heard so far, because a lot of this movie's been pretty tight under wraps. So same kind of question. What do you want from this movie? What are your hopes?
Alex, please.
Honestly, right now I have no idea. Like, I think they could go so many places with it, you know. I think I've heard things, you know, but they could have it tie in to some of this greater sort of Mandoverse thing that's sort of been building. And I kind of expect it to at least in some ways connect, but it could be sort of just a sort of standalone story with some of just sort of a bigger adventure for Mando and Grogu, you know? So I think that could be great. I think it could also be cool if it really connects to stuff, you know?
You know, I think the danger, because I kind of agree to your point, a standalone adventure would be fantastic. I think the danger is thinking about what Zack Snyder did and failed with DC Comics, trying to jam it all in, like falsely create, advancing the story too far. You know, because he tried to say, hey, I can do what Marvel did, and I'm going to jam all these characters into BBS, and then, boom, I'm going to be set up for success. Well, the Thrawn-averse Ahsoka story, it needs some time to, like, pollinate. Mm-hmm. You know, we need to have a second season of Ahsoka and potentially have whatever this project beyond that is and have it flower into 5 years down the road, 6 years down the road, then becoming the big Thrawn, big showdown, recasting Han, Luke, and Leia, you know, and Lando, and or having Donald Glover come back is more important, and then having the big showdown. But I just don't want Mando and Grogu to be, you know, Ahsoka season 1.5. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? To jam it in so tightly, I don't want to take on kind of that failed aspect of what sent the DCU under Snyder down in flames. You know, a 4-hour movie where we're trying to, you know, put 5 pounds, you know, 10 pounds of shit in a 5-pound bag. Can't happen. Give it the breathing room. There's lots of great story to tell, but you gotta let it soak, gotta let it marinate a little bit. So that's my take. Mark.
Yeah, I'm really curious if they are doing that. If they are setting up this movie as Mando almost being the like the Sam Jackson. Like he's got to assemble the Avengers. Mm-hmm. Thrawn is back here. Who does Mando know? Like this is this movie going to be like Zeb comes to him or Carson Teaver or someone like comes to him and is like, hey, shit's about to get real. We need you to kind of like go talk to Bo. She can walk on both paths. Go talk to like your little Jedi dude that like, you know, your frog buddy trained with for a week and a half. Can you help us? Because it's about to get real bad. And I'm wondering if this movie is, you know, in some way going to be like, we have to assemble a team here. It is going to kind of be like that, like a little bit of Ahsoka 1.5, a little bit of like another bit of like Mandalorian, a little bit of like Boba Fett, like bridging all of those shows together, like Alex, like you said, but like also in a way kind of setting up what comes next, right? Like without stepping on Ahsoka season 2, like I don't know if they'll bring her back in this, but like that's an interesting concept to think about of like, what if this movie is the place where they bring Ahsoka back? Like what if this movie is, this movie's about of like, hey, Mando and Grogu, we know you guys are the best bounty hunters in the galaxy. What about taking your skills to another galaxy? Because we've got someone lost and Thrawn's back and we need her. Go get her. And like this whole thing is like Mando and Grogu trying to figure out A, how to get to another galaxy, B, how to get Ahsoka and Sabine back, and C, like get back before Thrawn absolutely wrecks everything. Like,
I just feel like you'd be putting the cart before the horse. You know what I mean? It's just not really giving things a chance to breathe. I had this conversation with a lot of people recently because it was the 30th anniversary of Star Trek Generations, which followed the end of Star Trek The Next Generation by like 4 months. And it was not a great film. They had spent 2 years writing it, but the real danger is when you take a television show that just ended and jam it into a movie. What makes it cinematic? What makes it not just feel like 2.5 episodes of that, or 3 episodes of that show.
Mm-hmm.
That's the danger. So Mando, this movie has to be something apart, to Alex's point, from the storyline that I really feel like looking 5-6 years down the road is going to benefit from your MCU type. Like, it took us 10 years to get here, you know, and we did it as, you know, carefully as possible by, you know, planting a lot of seeds and letting things grow. I think the danger is the, you know, TNG to Generations getting something and trying to fit Captain Kirk in there and having it just be like, they could have done more. And then having the Snyderverse and what a train wreck that was. So that gives me some fear that it could go in that direction. So yes, I'd like to see it grow and let Mando do his own thing. Let it have some interconnectivity to his own show, but on a much grander scale, bigger stakes, bigger everything. Playing into the part of Grogu's life that is still being one with the Force, and what does that really mean? And yeah, I would like to see it more attached to Mando the show as opposed to everything else, because then you got a bunch of characters in there, everybody gets, you know, 98 seconds of screen time, and it's a cast of bajillions, you know, where that are needed to drive the story forward, but the story's just going in a lot of different directions. So
yeah, I'm hoping we'll find out sooner rather than later. This movie's what, 2026?
Yes. So
we've got the date they've attached to it. So we've got a little bit. I'm hoping for some teasers or some trailers or something.
Yeah,
maybe a poster or something.
Something. Jeez, description. Something. God.
I mean, 18 months out. My vibe as far as getting any kind of promo art might be New York Comic Con next year. So third, fourth quarter of 2025, where you start the spin cycle, because the summer film in 2026, and promoting it too early would be a waste because people don't have that much of an attention span. You've got to hit them close enough and then see a first trailer, Super Bowl 2026, guaranteed.
You think it's going to be that late? I'm thinking April.
Okay.
You're Star Wars Celebration, Japan.
Oh, yeah. Okay. So next year.
They're rolling this thing out big.
Okay.
2025.
Okay.
I'm thinking we're going to get, like, that's when we're going to really see some stuff for this. Mm-hmm. Like, late April, we are going to get the rollout for this, and the hype train's going to be starting. Like, Japan, Star Wars Celebration, that's the time to do it, right? Like,
let it grow for a year in the anticipation, you know.
Yeah. Like, I think even some teasers, like, maybe it's not leaked out to the public right away, or like not officially released to the public right away. Like, anyone that can't make it to Japan probably just can be sitting at home, like hoping someone snuck a camera in, or
somebody will, but then, yeah,
you know, manage to wear some Ray-Ban glasses or something.
Snatched,
like that thing.
Yeah.
You know, like something, but like, I think the people at Celebration are going to get a good view of this in April.
Mm-hmm.
Fair.
Yeah. And then we'll hear descriptions and stuff and know a little bit more about the direction. So we'll see who's right. We'll see if any of us are right.
Yeah.
Hopefully in April.
It'll be a worthy journey regardless.
For sure. Can't wait. Star Wars back in a theater. That's going to be exciting either way.
Yeah.
Long time. Seven years after the fact. 7 years since the, 2019.
Has it really been? Jeez, that's crazy.
Yeah. Wow. Well, I mean, they've been building this TV universe and canceling movies, announcing and canceling movies. That's a lot of work.
Yeah. Very busy announcing movies that have never shown up.
Exactly.
Let's get into something that has shown up and just
content,
dropped.
Content we watched. Oh, my God.
Jump right in to the Skeleton Crew.
Yes.
So brand new story. But still happening at the same time. We're going to talk about that in a second. I have a note here to talk about when this takes place and a minor tie into the Mandoverse. But first off, as it stands, we've got 2 episodes so far. What are your initial impressions on these two episodes as a group? I think let's talk about them as a group, but we can pick bits and pieces from episode one and two. But overall, so far, two episodes in, Alex, how are you feeling?
Oh man, I gotta say, I really, really loved the first two episodes. The opening of the first episode, I was like, as soon as they started like boarding, I was like, I'm in. Like, this is just pirates, pirates in space, and I'm so, I'm so here for this.
Lots of, lots of pew, 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 bang, bangs.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
Yep.
Oh my God.
No, I just thought it was so good.
Yeah, I
read a headline, you know, because obviously, you know, everyone's seen it. You've got your media reactions going out, and I don't know who I cite it from, but it says this will make you fall in love with Star Wars again. Mm-hmm. And let's think about how vital that really is. Now, Mark, you are one of the few people that I know personally that enjoyed The Acolyte. It's otherwise largely reviled. You know, the morale is very low for a lot of Star Wars fans. People are wondering, how can they bring it back? You know, how can they bring it back to basics? And let's face it, basics, the most addressing of the childlike wonder that is, you know, Galaxy Far, Far Away, was Return of the Jedi, the Ewoks, the Caravan of Courage, you know, the other Ewok movie, the name that I'm forgetting. That was as elemental as you get for speaking to kids, you know. And in this, I mean, I watched a couple of breakdown videos today. I watched both of Ryan Aries on Screen Crush. I watched one of the new Rockstars videos. You know, this all the little nods, music cues, connections back to E.T. in particular, you know, casting our main character is making him feel like Elliot and E.T., you know, having an absent parent who works all the time, you know, and you know, doesn't connect with their kid. You don't have the big brother, you know, the big brother and sister element that you had within the family in E.T. in this, but you do have it with a group of friends, because a group of friends is less important in E.T., where it's pivotal here, because you've got your great preteen kids, you know, two girls, two boys playing like, oh, you know, girls are yucky, oh, boys are yucky, blah blah blah, you know, and just every aspect of this, worked. It was the best thing I've seen in a very long time coming out of Disney Star Wars.
I don't know the last time I like laughed out loud at Star Wars like this, like, and like, you know, trying, like, there's been stuff in Star Wars that you see and it's like, oh God, what were they thinking? And you laugh at that kind of thing. But like, this was like, they're genuinely funny moments. And you know what it reminded me of, with a lot of the kids dialogue, especially, have you seen like the newest, like Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, like the Mutant Mayhem? Did you watch that movie?
I haven't seen it yet, but I got to, cause it's getting good. I've heard good spin.
It was really, really good. But one of the things that made that movie work so well is that the teenage in Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles was a whole lot earlier than any other Ninja Turtles project that they've done.
Right.
So this is like, we're talking like 13, 14 year old Ninja Turtles rather than like 18, 19. And they got age appropriate kids. And for a lot of the dialogue, they just put them all in a room together and let them be kids and let them riff and let them just like make fun of each other, rip up everyone, rip up the directors, rip up anyone that was in the room, and like just be goofy, stupid kids. And like, you can tell they did the same kind of thing with this show, or the person writing it really, really knows kids well because like, and I mean, that's not super surprising, because look at the Spider-Man trilogy, like they know, like he knows how to write kids. Right. But like, there was that similar vibe of like, you can just tell, like, and there's a clip out today that Star Wars released about the kids doing just that. The kids got together, they had dinner with everyone, they got to hang out together, they started nicknaming and ripping up all the adults on set. Every single adult, they said they'd like pick out a funny laugh or pick out something, call them like I think it was like the Duffer Brothers or something like that. They started calling them the Donut Brothers. And like, these are kids that are just let loose to be kids.
Yeah.
And it comes across in every single scene of this, where it's just like, this is Star Wars, but it's such a earthbound, like, kind of writing. Like, you feel it, you know, those kids, or you were those kids. Like, there's so much of this stuff that I'm like watching and I'm just like, oh yeah, that's me. Like, seeing that flashing button. No way. I'm not touching that.
Right. Do not touch butt. Yes. Oh my gosh.
Yeah. So good.
Wow.
So good.
Yeah, it was just fun. You know, I think that's a great way to describe it, is that it just really captured that fun of like the Star Wars universe.
Yeah.
Yes.
Like I said, and I hate to keep, you know, dragging Alkalite as I could, but there was nothing about that made you smile. There was nothing about it that was fun.
Yeah.
It was grim. It was gritty. The plot, a lot of the directions they picked, I wouldn't have picked. And people didn't like it. I mean, the ratings unfortunately spoke for themselves, which is why the show's not around anymore. There was nothing about this that I can even fathom that anyone with, you know, two ears and a heart, you know, people who listen to Phil Collins, that you couldn't, that anyone couldn't love. You see, you just got it, didn't you? There was nothing about this that anyone who hasn't, particularly people of my generation, we Gen Xers, who grew up in the 80s, and we grew up with The Goonies when we were very young. We grew up with E.T. when we were even younger. To see that tied, it felt like Steven Spielberg must have, his fingerprints were all over this deal. You know, this was him without, I believe it's without being him. I don't believe he's involved, but it feels like he's involved.
Yeah.
So whoever is, and I think John Watts is the creator. He's the Spider-Man guy. Yeah, Spider-Man guy who gave us Tom Holland as Spider-Man, the best Spider-Man in a trilogy, in my quadrilogy, and no trilogy at this point. They're making another trilogy. One, but I just, and being a dyed-in-the-wool Spider-Man fan, I actually just found out tonight, you know, a little plug, speaking of Kurt, is getting us an interview with J.K. Simmons. Happening in the next couple of months. I got to get back with his agent, really. So just thinking of J. Jonah Jameson, because Spider-Man is my other first love after Star Wars.
That's weird.
But John Watts knows how to give us fun and relatable, genuine interactions with young people. And, I just so endlessly impressed by what I saw.
Yeah, absolutely. It's got that Steven Spielberg, John Hughes, like Goonies, E.T., Stranger Things, Super 8, if you remember, like underrated
yeah,
movie.
Yeah, great flick.
Like that kind of, like Kids on Bikes. That if that's a genre of movie, like it's Kids on Bikes thrown kids into a speeders. Mystery. And
adventure.
Yeah, right? Like it's the same kind of deal. And they're like you said, man, you boil it right down, Alex. Like it was just fun.
Mm-hmm.
And then you throw in pirates and like the second danger. Episode,
the stakes. Yeah. The big stakes,
like Tortuga vibes for that. Like place of the, if you haven't caught on already, by the way, dear listener, full spoilers ahead. Sorry for not mentioning that 5 minutes ago, but like, you know,
Yeah, I think you can
do what you will.
Yeah, I think people who are dialed into what we do are watching things day and date or shortly thereafter. So
I hope so. But like, full spoilers ahoy from now on, because like, pirates, holy crap! So they go off planet and they meet pirates, and it's like the biggest Tortuga vibe from like, you know, Pirates of the Caribbean franchise. Like you said, the show started off with that pirate vibe, and then kind of lost it for a minute, and then came back to it with the second episode. Mm-hmm. But before we get into that kind of stuff, because I want to talk about like scenes and moments and different set pieces and stuff. First off, characters, we've already mentioned their interactions and just like standout performances from the kids and it feeling so natural, but like any character standing out, to either of you guys,
you know, it's going to take me a minute to lock on to all the character names, because right now I don't know that I could tell you any of them. I think the little guy's name was Wynn or Wyndham. Wynn?
Wynn. Wynn.
Okay, that's one. Little girl's name is the one who's kind of like Tom Sawyer, who gets them to dig the thing out. Is her name like Leaf or Leaf or something?
It's Fern.
Fern, you see? Fern, Leaf. It's four letters. It's very green. So I was going in the right direction. All the kids are kind of one glob, and they're great because they personify every aspect of a TV/movie 80s kid trope that's very enjoyable. Mm-hmm. All of that. I would say absolutely all of that.
Yeah. Alex?
I mean, Neil, you know, he's just so great. You know, I just, every time he was on screen, I was just smiling. I was just like, Neil, like, oh, I just love him. I just think just like his design, it's just like perfect. You know, he's just like the perfect level of like, you know, that like fun and everything about him, you know?
So, yeah.
Perfect level of like cute, but like also just instantly gives like best friend vibes, kind of thing. And like,
you're kind of,
you're so good.
Yeah. You're chubby best friend, but like not a bad bone in his body. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's like the friend also, you don't deserve, but just like the best friend in the world.
He's like, if you fail your test, I'll fail my test too. So we can still be buddies. So and cute. I'm really in love with this one girl in our class, but you never speak to her. Yeah, I know. I'm working on it or whatever. Like, oh,
so innocent. You know? So cute.
And I love, you know, the town itself that they live in is a set piece too. And it's so mysterious. Everything from talking about the indoctrination of these kids, you know, take your test so that you can take your standardized test. They did that in an early episode of The Simpsons too. Take your standardized test, and like Bart faked his, and then he got into the smart class or something. So that we can all take our place in the great work. And that sounds very ominous. And their planet is surrounded by a green energy shield, yet they still have New Republic money. So it's not like they've been living under this weird shell for
was
generations.
It New Republic money or High it Republic was, money?
It was New Republic money because it was my personal.
Yeah, they called it Old Republic.
Yeah, but yeah. it was. But this was not part of the Old Republic. This is the Starbird. Remember, because they did show one of the coins. You know what? Maybe. You know what I'm thinking of? I'm thinking of the pirates. The pirates getting their hands on this. The kid Wynn had. Old ships Republic. Or whatever. So now that you mention it, they may be some kind of terraform protected, you know, living under a dome kind of society. And the reason, you know, the eternal treasure is what they're, you know, I mean, that's a sci-fi plot that goes back, as you know, Star Trek has done it, and you know, all other, you know, X-Files has done it. Other shows have done it with the protected society that hides, hides itself from the outside world. Yeah, you're right. I crossed that up because it was the pirates that were looking to acquire the New Republic money. But when you saw Wynn fumbling with his weird little, you know, tall, you know, coins to trade, they had different symbols on them.
Yeah.
And all their school jackets have the Omega symbol on them as well. With their little uniforms. So there's definitely more that's going on, but for the fact also that entire setting is unlike anything else you've seen. It looks completely it looks completely untouched, where everything in the Star Wars uniform looks touched because the Empire ravaged everything. So anything that's out there looks really trashed, where this is very pristine and it looks like, you know, it looks like the San Bernardino Valley. You know what I mean? It's just, that's exactly how they built it up.
Yeah. It's just a regular like suburbs. Like,
yeah.
That doesn't happen in Star Wars.
Yeah, exactly.
It's very interesting to see. And I do love that it's growing a mystery. I really thought that most of the show was going to be like, you know, the kids just went really far and have to kind of get back and they're dealing with these pirates. Mm-hmm. But like, the getting back part being so difficult and such a mystery, I did not expect for a second.
Yeah.
Very, very interesting. I do have to give, I didn't give a shout out to any characters and you guys picked a couple of great ones, but I do have to give a shout out to KB because I think it has to be so difficult to play the serious kid. And there are a couple of like shining moments of like, you know, Smee, who I'm going to just call him Smee because he's my other breakout character. SM33 played by Nick Frost. It's Smee. Pirates of the freaking like Captain Hook, like just on. So yeah, when he's going through and he's like, this is this and this is this and this is it, and all the other kids are just like, hey, that one's flashing. Hey, what's this button do? I didn't hear a word you said. And she's just like, yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah,
I just like 100%. There's a couple of those moments that are just like, oh man, she's playing like the straight dude so good in this.
Yes.
And for a kid, when it seems like the rest of the kids were just let loose, like that takes some discipline.
Yeah.
And just like a special kind of actor to fit in with that crew and be able to like act like she wants to play pranks and do this kind of thing. Like we saw them with, like, we saw the girls play pranks on the guys early on when they're starting stuff. But also being able to play like the half droid character or like something with a much more toned down personality. I really think KB by the end of this is going to be like a standout kind of character.
Yeah.
Because of that, like underratedness. So we've talked about a couple of like giant set pieces and really cool things. Any like scenes, moments, set pieces, other things other than like the characters themselves that stood out to you guys?
Charlie,
you already said like the planet itself.
I've got a great one, and it's funny, Mark. We're the only Star Wars podcast that has never talked about the holiday special. And I think maybe next year we should.
We really should, yeah.
I'm finally jump into that. So next November we'll do that. But incorporating that weird circus hologram thing that the little brothers, the twins that are part of the best friend's family are watching. We were howling about that because my wife hates the holiday special. Watched it once when we first got together, so this was over 10 years ago, and it has been banned ever since. And I have a bootleg copy on disc that I got at Wizard World in Chicago that Todd and I were there like 15 years ago. That is great. It was recorded off a TV station in Baltimore, all these original commercials and stuff. It's horrendous. It's absolutely horrendous. Piece of film.
I watched it once maybe 10 to 12 years ago and haven't gone back. There's a reason we haven't talked about it on this show, because I haven't watched it and I don't want to, but I will for this show.
We have to. I have watched a lot of really bad things in the course of the work that we do on this podcast network. So we won't talk about 2015's Fantastic Four, because I saw that and Todd didn't. That was our deal. And he went and saw Joker. No, he didn't. He was going to go see Joker 2, and he didn't, because I refuse to.
Dodge that. Those little nods that they've been doing in this of, you know, whatever it is. I think KB says something that's a reference to Harrison Ford's character in American Graffiti, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes, Bob like
challenging
Falta.
The other kids.
Bob Falta was that, and they flipped it around. And made it something. I gotta love American Graffiti. What a great flick.
Alex, any scenes, moments, shots, set pieces, anything non-character related that really stood out to you?
Yeah, I think like what stands out to me was the ship. You know, when they're digging the ship, they're digging out. You know, I thought, you know, what we've seen of that so far has been so well designed. You know.
Yeah.
You know, like it feels, you know, it feels old. It feels like a big ship, you know, like it was kind of creepy.
Very, very ghost ship kind of vibe. Ghost ship.
We saw a little bit of the like the captain's cabin that looks kind of like, you know, like a pirate ship cabin that you'd expect. Oh, I thought that was really cool. And
big one-eyed Willy kind of it was also giving me vibes from like National Treasure, like the first National Treasure movie. They find like that ship that's buried in the Arctic kind of thing.
Right.
And the Charlotte And it's very kind of similar vibes, right? Of like this frozen in time kind of ship, yeah. And like the crew's kind of dead or here or there, or whatever. And like one of them's holding on to something, like very, very National Treasure kind of vibes for that ship,
which I love.
That was great.
Yeah, just some really good, you know, like old looking Star Wars, you know, Millennium Falcon kind of style, you know.
Yeah, there is an element of mystery. Surrounding, you know, the shielded, potentially cloaked planet. Why was there, you know, a ship crashed upside down, buried in the woods? Where did that come from? How long has it been there? Why, you know, did all the people on the ship kill each other? What was going on? I'm excited to see, you know, unlike, you know, other programs, and I'm not using names, that maybe didn't give us a payoff but tried to give us a mystery that ultimately you were like, oh, who gives a shit. This we're already also invested because we're seeing all of this through the eyes of not only these characters but ourselves, feeling how we grew up being a part of that Amblin Entertainment, Spielberg, John Hughes ish kind of world. So this did bring back my faith in Star Wars. It really did. Absolutely spectacular.
I mentioned it before, but like the Tortuga vibes of this like floating like planet ship thing, pirate haven that they land in.
Like nowhere
one from Guardians. One love that, like nowhere from Guardians. Loved just this pirate haven, obviously really cool, like pirate vibes, but also very reminiscent of the first Star Wars movie of A New Hope.
Yeah.
Walking into, you know, the cantina, like there's music, there's aliens, there's things. Every single time you look at any different scene, you're going to notice 100 different little tiny things in there that I'm sure on rewatches from this, you're going to see little things. Like, I can't wait to rewatch every single scene from that because there's so much going on. And like new Star Wars creatures, old Star Wars creatures, great little like nods to this and that and whatever else. But one thing that I have to I have to point out, we heard like the little whistle kind of thing when the kids were in the finally in the pirate brig. Really brought up memories of like the Pirates of the Caribbean ride, of like the prisoners like holding the bone out for the dog and be like,
yep.
So good.
When Neil had the little rat creature, I was like, Pirates of the Caribbean, I know that.
And it was pointed out one of the videos that I watched that was very much like Rocket and Yondu trying to get little Groot, to get his fin, and he kept coming back with the wrong stuff. But in this case, the little rat thing just crawls up on the key, and he just pees on it and goes, you know, and But that gives us our big reveal, which I know dog legs into your next point here. Yeah.
So, Jod, aka Jude Law, aka Handsome McPirate Pants. I don't guy. So let's play some bets or just give our thoughts. Is he a Jedi or former Jedi who basically did what they could, kind of a la Cal Kestis, but like this guy got in with pirates instead of like scrappers?
Yeah.
Former Jedi, Sith-esque character, you know, more dark side, which, you know, would explain the piratey stuff, or something else. Could this guy just be someone that's attuned to the Force? Because we know that the Force is kind of everywhere. That's been more and more established in Star Wars that there are more paths to the Force than just Jedi and Sith. Could this guy just be a natural talent? Could this guy just be like a Jack Sparrow that happened to get piss load of drunk on Spotska one night and just was like, hey, I want another one. And then the glass floated to his hand. He was was neat.
That's 100%. Because I think it's painfully obvious that he is the Cobra Commander mask wearing pirate guy in the opening sequence, which, by the way, the opening sequence was practically shot for shot the beginning of episode 4. Loved all the touches there. It was absolutely great. But that's him. That's why he's in the cell. And you're right. He's just like, one day he said, hey, I need to, you know what? I need to pick up my phone. And my phone's, you know, I left my phone in the bathroom. And he holds his hand up and it flies into his hand. Yeah, he's not a Jedi. He's not a Sith. He's just kind of a dude. And we don't know if he's a good dude. We'll find out if he's like, hey, kids, I'll help you. But then I'm like, I'm going to steal your ship and I'm going to, you know, I'm going to leave you at the bus stop. He just seems like he's a bad guy, you know, because he's a pirate and he's got a creepy helmet. So obviously for the younger viewers, that might be a big reveal. Like, oh, it wasn't a surprise that Padme and her handmaiden were, that really the handmaiden was Padme, where all the characters acted surprised, like, oh, where... Come on. You know what I mean? So, yes, it's absolutely him. Yeah, I'm going to place my bets. He's a bad guy. He'll have a bad guy arc, maybe a la Han Solo, but a little darker, where he'll do something crappy to sell the kids out. But at the end of it, he'll find his humanity and he'll save them. And maybe he lives, maybe he dies. But I don't know. I think he's a bad guy. I think he knows a little bit about the Force, but he's no Jedi. He's no Sith. He's no practitioner. He's just, hey, I want this bag of Doritos across the room. Yeah, that's him.
I kind of love that theory. Alex, how you feeling about Jor so far?
Jor-Jod.
I don't think he's a Jedi. You know, I think that's, I don't think so. I don't think he's a Sith either. Now, I kind of like the idea that he is force sensitive in some way, even if he's, you know, sort of like using that selfishly, but not in an evil way, I think could be an interesting thing, you know, that we haven't really seen before. Like he's out for himself, but not really for like any like evil reason, you know, like taking over the galaxy. Just he's only concerned about himself, you know, so I think that could be interesting. Right.
Yeah, like a very Jack Sparrow kind of like.
Yeah,
you can't really trust him, but like not in like a Barbossa stab you in the back way. Like kind of just like a you don't really know what he's gonna do kind of way. Yeah. But like it's fun to watch.
You know, maybe he like knew Jedi, you know, in his past or something, and maybe, you know, kind of like Sabine, like, you know, wasn't necessarily gifted but can do some things, you know, through like training or something. I don't know. I'm really interested to see where it goes.
Totally agree.
I just, because you guys said that, and that's kind of my bet too, but like, I'm going to just play devil's advocate here and say, he was a Jedi survivor. He did survive Order 66. And like I said, Cal Kestis kind of got in with some scrappers. He met some good people, tried to stay under the radar. This guy just did what he had to do to survive. And then things got progressively worse from there. You know, maybe he is a gentleman pirate. Maybe he's not. Maybe he's just ended up doing some shit things, because in his perspective, the universe is kind of shit anyway, because all of his friends died, or all of his friends killed the people that he loved, you know, the Order 66 style, like the clones. Like we saw, I was just talking to someone about this, like Cal Kestis, and like how heart-wrenching that scene was, because they set it up of like him, you know, it flashbacks of like Cal talking to the clones on his way to training and like being buddy buddy with all these clones, and then it shows them killing his mentor, and it's a very short couple of scenes in those games, like in the grand scheme of all those games, but like it hits so hard because it sets it up of like, these aren't enemies killing your, you know, essential father figures. Like these are your brothers and your best friends killing your father figures and your best friends. And it's just like everything in the world betrays you. So why not in Jod's case, why not betray the world or the galaxy? I could see them swinging it that way. And then we will have, you know, that the Wim just absolutely loses his mind that he's hanging out with a Jedi.
It's TMPH, too much to handle.
So final thing I want to ask you guys before we start to wrap up, We mentioned earlier, I mentioned earlier that we had one subtle hint in this to give away when this happens in the Star Wars timeline. We saw Vane.
Right.
He is one of the pirates that showed up in Mandalorian season 3 when they were doing the big pirate attack
he worked for Greg. The salad guys, Swamp.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Old Greg, Swampy the Hutt, whatever you want to call him. But
The Hutt. Yeah, there you go.
So Vane showing up in this shows that most likely this is happening around the same time, probably after Mando season 3. Do you guys want this to be more of a standalone show with those kind of subtle hints to like maybe other characters, like very much side characters? Or do you want this by the end of it to be like, we just opened up into the Mandoverse. Here's another pirate Jedi sort of someone, if you know, Jod survives all of this, on Mando's potential team for taking on Thrawn or whatever. Like, do you want this to mix with Mandoverse, or are you kind of okay with this just being like its own thing? Alex?
Yeah, I personally, I think I'd like give it to more say kind of separate, you know, and I think that's kind of the way it's gonna go if I had to guess, just because you know, it's called like in the posters, you know, it's called like a Star Wars story or a Star Wars event. I forget the exact wording.
Right.
But that kind of makes me feel like it's going to be a little more standalone, less like in the sort of connected universe. But I like having the little connections, like you said, like the little side characters showing up just to, you know, remind you where we are and, you know, that it is all taking place in a connected universe, even if it is more of a standalone story, you know?
Right. Yeah. Oh, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. I couldn't agree more. Again, when you try to cram too much into, well, this fits where we're headed, you get Ant-Man Quantumania. You know what I mean? Mm. That movie made no sense and was garbage.
Yeah. I wanted that movie to be better. Yeah.
I know, but it's just like you try to cram Kang in with Ant-Man, and these are two characters that don't have interrelativity. Trying to make this a component of it's kind of like where Book of Boba Fett went wrong. It wasn't strong enough to stand on its own, so let's jam Mando in there and Grogu too, because hey, look, it's Baby Yoda's back, and we can get people interested again. Because it just wasn't getting the job done. So this is so strong on its own that to bring in other elements to force a connectivity issue would be a huge disservice. So I'm hoping this will be on its own. Now, does that mean we see Joey Georgiad later on down the road, Jude Law doing his thing? Maybe, or maybe it's the heroic sacrifice. Heroic sacrifice works too. You know, like I said, he goes through a character arc of discovery where he's a bad guy. He sells the kids out. Then he figures out he's a jerk. He gets them back and dies in a glorious fashion. That would work for me. That would be okay.
I like that. If it doesn't end that way, I'm completely agreeing with you guys that I don't want, like, especially Charlie, like I do not want an episode of this to like, hey, let's pause the kid's story and go see what Mando's up to. Like, if they do that, I will just.
How's Bo-Katan doing today?
Like,
mind. I will hate every second of that. Even if it's a great story, like I thought those episodes of Book of Boba Fett were great, but like, why?
Yeah.
Why are they in this? And I will say the same thing about this if it happens. But I will say, if Jod doesn't go out in that kind of blaze of glory, then I think leaving this as a separate, but allowing for those characters to like in the future, like, you know, hey, Jod, okay, I got the kids back safely. Hey, you know what? I wonder what's happening in the rest of the universe. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, that leaves the potential for Jod to be out there finding Mando or finding Ezra or something along those lines of like, you know, somewhere he can show up in one of these later projects. And if that happens, if this show is as good as the first two episodes have indicated, I don't hate that, that some of these characters can continue.
Yeah. Make Neil a Jedi, you know, that's fine.
Yeah. Right. Like, let's, oh man, can you imagine? and like Wim just losing his mind that his best friend is the Jedi and has Force powers instead of him.
It's Bart and Milhouse.
Dude, I love that more than anything we've said tonight.
He's like Fallout Boy. He'll be like Fallout Boy. Yeah.
I need that so bad. Like just this, I need this whole show to end with Neil like moving something with his mind and just cutting to Wim being like,
come on.
Yep. Oh man, that is fantastic. And I think that's where we have to end it tonight. This was an amazing two episodes. I think we're all in agreement on that one. I can't wait to see more. Alex, thank you so much for jumping in with us, man. This was
an awesome
way to spend our 100th episode. Tell people where they can find you on the internet.
Yeah, I'm on all the socials. It's Turbo Nerd. It's Turbo underscore Nerd, and then another underscore.
Just for good measure.
Yeah, you know, Instagram, TikTok are my main ones, but I'm all over the place. So yeah, I do a lot of Star Wars and other nerdy content. So
cool,
excellent, cool. Excellent. Thanks again for joining us.
Yeah.
Yes.
Charlie.
I am finally these days under one tag under most all the socials. That would be now Blue Sky, but Threads and Instagram. I am at the C3, TheCeeTheCreeTree. I also spend a hell of a lot of time on our Secret Friends Unite Discord. That's the most funnest corner of the internet. Don't look it up, but it's true. We have a lot of fun discussions.
Totally official.
Fun civil discussions about the world of nerd and geekery, about Star Trek, Star Wars, Marvel Comics, and et cetera. That's where I'm at. Mark, what about you?
You can find me everywhere as Knerdian underscore Jedi, except Blue Sky, which doesn't allow you to do underscores. But I just made an account, and I don't think I've posted anything there yet. So
follow me
on Instagram. But that's about it. And of course, hanging out in our Discord group.
Absolutely. Cool. Very good. Well, friends, thanks for joining us. Thanks for tuning in. That's the end of the show. As always, I will tell you that sharing is caring and to keep on trucking. Keep on trucking. That's the one.
May the force be with you. Rex, play us out.